Pilot Captain Torrance, on his way to the plane, contacts his daughter Daniela to check on her and assures her that he will see her soon. He apologizes to his new co-pilot, Dele, for his delay. Dele reassures him, mentioning that the flight officer hasn't arrived yet. Torrance becomes concerned upon learning that they will be flying through severe weather. He asks the flight dispatcher if they can take an eastern route, coming north over Luzon. The dispatcher responds that it's not possible because it would add an hour of flight time and require an additional 18,000 pounds of fuel. Since the flight has few passengers, they need to keep it shorter. Meanwhile, Flight Chief Bonnie approaches Torrance to inform him that he is needed at the jetway. There, he meets with a police officer who requests transportation for a fugitive named Louis, convicted of homicide 15 years ago, to Toronto. The officer explains that they will accompany Louis as far as Tokyo. Torrance hesitates because he is concerned about attracting attention and frightening the passengers. However, he realizes there's no other option and pleads with the officer to keep a low profile. He also instructs the flight chiefs to minimize their interactions with Louis. There are only 14 passengers on this flight, and some express concerns about the plane's age. Torrance reassures them, explaining that these planes are known for their durability. The plane takes off, and Bonnie serves drinks and food to the passengers. In the meantime, a woman asks her friend to secretly take a picture with Louis, but he notices and politely asks them not to. Torrance is impressed by Dele's beautiful family. He mentions that he only has a daughter, as his wife passed away 3 years ago, and Dele expresses sympathy. Sometime later, they encounter severe turbulence as they cut through the top of a storm. Torrance instructs passengers to fasten their seatbelts. He repeatedly requests permission from the air traffic controller to climb to 40,000 feet to avoid the weather, but there is no response until the turbulence subsides. They experience another shock of turbulence, and Torrance reassures passengers that they are simply going through rough weather. Suddenly, lightning strikes the plane, causing the avionics to shut down and injuring Torrance, who begins bleeding. He returns to his seat and asks Dele to check the breakers and reset them, but there is no response because there is no power. The radio is also dead, so the air traffic controller doesn't hear Torrance's requests for help. They are now running on battery power, with only 10 minutes of power left. Torrance sets a timer and asks Dele to call out the remaining time, 1 minute at a time. Bonnie informs the passengers about the electrical malfunction, and requests that they securely fasten their seatbelts. Meanwhile, the police officer gets up from his seat to retrieve his phone, inadvertently causing him and one of the chiefs, Isabella, to lose their lives when the plane rotates. The plane eventually breaks through the heavy storm, and everyone tries to remain calm while enduring one of the worst situations. With only 4 minutes remaining, Torrance decides to attempt a water landing. Bonnie instructs passengers to brace for impact. As they are on the brink of despair, Torrance becomes excited upon catching a glimpse of an island and decides to make an emergency landing there. The landing is not smooth, but they successfully make it, and Torrance hurries to get everyone out. The airline manager, Terry, is informed about the plane that went missing somewhere west of the Philippines. He instructs the staff to contact David Scarsdale. Dele wonders what they are going to do with Louis. Torrance has no idea because it's new for him. However, he tells Bonnie and Dele to keep their eyes on him and keep him separate from the other passengers. Bonnie then gives Torrance the key to the cuffs that she took from the cop. Torrance thanks everyone for their cooperation and apologizes for what they've just had to go through. He tells them that they got hit by lightning, and their main power and communications are down. So, as of now, there is no way of calling for help. He asks them to remain calm, and once the plane cools down, they can retrieve their belongings and figure out what they're going to do next. He assures them that he will get them out of here safely. Terry introduces David to everyone, who is known for specializing in corporate strategy and crisis management. David is curious about who sent the plane flying through that storm, and the flight dispatcher responds that he thought they could fly above it because the flight was light, and it was the most efficient route. Terry asks David for suggestions on how to find the plane, and David suggests that the best option right now is to hire mercenaries, which he has already contacted. Everyone then begins building a shelter, and one of the passengers, Sinclair, is curious why they can't just stay in the plane. Torrance responds that without air conditioning, the plane will become unbearably hot in the sun, so they're better off outside with the shelter and a breeze. He encourages everyone to share bug spray, sunscreen, or food if they have any. Torrance approaches Louis, telling him he's not quite sure what they're supposed to do with him. Louis replies that he's not going to escape into the unknown jungle, especially not with handcuffs on unless Torrance offers to unlock them. Torrance then checks the plane's engine and discovers that the radio is fried. Regarding the transponder, it's hard to tell due to the lack of power. Bonnie informs him that the plane is fully unloaded except for the bodies and personal belongings. He takes the cop's gun and retrieves Louis' belongings, such as his wallet, watch, and pocket knife. Meanwhile, a man records a video, recounting what just happened and swearing not to fly on that Trailblazer plane anymore. Delay informs Torrance that this island is very dangerous, run by separatists and criminals. There is no government or police presence, and they are not safe here. Torrance asks Delay to keep this information to themselves for now. Louis becomes angry upon seeing the man recording him and yells at everyone to keep him out of their videos. David tells Terry that he needs him to make an on-camera statement for the press. They will have a prepared statement, but Terry will also need to take questions. Terry is curious why they shouldn't wait until they know more. David responds that waiting might make it look like they're hiding something. He advises Terry to show concern and humility. He asks the dispatcher to provide him with all available information about that plane, such as flight time, maintenance logs, and the names of the technicians who last serviced the plane. Torrance plans to take Louis with him to find help since they are running out of options. He tells Delay that he won't tie up Louis because, if he runs, at least everyone else will be safe from him. Torrance informs everyone that after he and Delay have calculated, they believe that they have landed on an island somewhere in the Jolo Cluster. The problem is that the area between where the transponder was struck by lightning and their current location is vast, so search and rescue efforts could take some time. Last night, they flew over some kind of facility, and he's hoping they have a phone or radio. If he can get there and make contact, they could be rescued in hours. Two men then ask to go with him, but he refuses, surprising them by taking a guy in handcuffs instead. We find out that this island is led by Dadu, who is in the Filipino army. A man informs Dadu that he saw a plane fly over his house last night and land at the old mine. Hajin asks if he's sure it wasn't an army plane, and Dadu tells him it's not. If it were, his spies in Melina would have warned him. Meanwhile, Daniela becomes very concerned when she finds out about her dad's plane's disappearance. Torrance asks Louis if he was a former military member or something because he found his pocket knife. Louis replies that he was in the Group des Commandos Parachutistes when he was 18. After a while, Torrance discovers that Louis has escaped to somewhere else. While Torrance is out, Delay spends his time fixing the engine, and he's surprised that the power turns back on. Eventually, Torrance arrives at the building but realizes it is abandoned. He gets excited upon finding there is a telephone and fixes it to make it work. David hires John to work for him. He has no idea where the plane is, but he is sure that it is not in Macau, and John is happy to know that because that's going to be great pay for him. Torrance contacts the airline and tells the employees that the plane has gone down on an island in the Sulu Sea, but they don't take him seriously. They think he is prank calling them, as they have been getting calls all day about this. They ask for his badge number for verification, and sadly, he left it on the plane. Without his badge, they don't believe him and hang up the phone. So, he contacts Daniela instead and tells her to write down everything he says and get it to Trailblazer. Then he gets attacked by a man from behind and gets into a fight. He defeats the man by choking him out and hides himself after hearing gunshots. Louis suddenly shows up with two assault guns that he got from the men he killed earlier, and provides one to Torrance. Hajin informs Dadu that he found the plane on the mining road, but he doesn't know how many people are there since he didn't get close enough to see, so Dadu arranges to get a closer look. Meanwhile, Torrance and Louis come across passports and discover that the foreigners who came here got kidnapped by those Filipino armies, so Torrance hurries to get back to the passengers. The passengers get excited upon seeing cars coming. They don't know those are bad guys yet until they fire shots to scare them. Louis becomes aware of the situation after hearing the gunshots and forces Torrance to stop the car. Hajin asks Bonnie to give him the passenger list and is curious where Captain Torrance went. Delay nervously tells him that he went out looking for help while having a gun pointed at his head. Then Hajin kills a woman who attempts to run and beheads her husband as well. Torrance and Louis can do nothing since there are many soldiers except to watch them in shock. Then Dadu takes everyone to his village. After they leave, Torrance gets out to attack one of Dadu's men who is left behind to gather information from him. He says that Dadu takes everyone to Dangelit village and keeps them in the warehouse, then puts them out on the boat. But he doesn't know where Dadu is sending them to. Torrance wants to go after them, but Louis suggests he should not and wait for help. Though, he doesn't listen because the contact he made, he has no idea how much it got through and he is not waiting here to find out. Terry plays a recording of the call that Torrance made while he was in the building, and they assume that the plane is somewhere in the Jolo Island cluster. David tells Terry that he needs keyhole satellite access to those areas to find the plane. His assets are going airborne, and they will circle the Jolo cluster until they receive the location. Before leaving for Dangelet Village, Torrance leaves a message on his shirt for the rescue team when they arrive. After a while, Terry finds the plane on that Jolo Island, and David sends the coordinates to his assets. Torrance and Louis then stop 2 kilometers before the village and walk barefoot to get there while Hagen forces 5 people to tell their names and countries. John informs David that there are 4 dead bodies, including Dadu's men and the passengers. He comes across the message that Torrance left in the pilot's seat and realizes they have a hostage situation. Torrance and Louis launch a sneak attack on 2 men while they are preparing the fuel and kill the cell guards to rescue the passengers. They load back up on the bus to go to the plane, but Louis stops them as there are a bunch of armies on the road. They are going to get mowed down if they try to drive past them, and it will only draw more of them if Louis engages. So, Torrance decides to give himself up to distract them. He asks to speak with Dadu and tells him that many soldiers are being sent here, so he will have to release his passengers. Dadu gives him a beating and says that he is in Jolo now, and everything here belongs to him, even the passengers. He claims that no one cares when a small man dies, but if he makes an example of a big man like Torrance, everyone cares and pays. Just as Hagen is about to kill him, John and his team arrive in time to save him. After retrieving Torrance, they fall back to the bus and leave for the plane. Dadu is upset about Hagen's death and orders all of his men to go after them. Torrance is curious about who John and his team are, and John responds that they are Trailblazers Forward Advance Crew. He explains that the Trailblazers rescue team might arrive in 24 hours, so unfortunately, they have now become the rescue team themselves. He tells Torrance that he did bring an emergency fund with him, but it's not enough to buy their way out of this island. So, he asks Torrance for suggestions on what they should do, and Torrance also has a plan. He tells the passengers that he has to get them out of here with the plane, but they protest. He reassures them that if he didn't believe it could be done, he wouldn't have put them back on that plane. He also mentions that he has a daughter, and he fully intends to hug her again. Everyone hurries to board the plane while John and his team prepare to confront Dadu. Torrance asks John to buy him some time as he needs to fix the brakes first. As Dadu and his men arrive, a shootout ensues, where Dadu's men can't keep up with John's team, armed with heavy weapons like snipers that can pierce through metal. Torrance asks John for his walkie-talkie and tells him that he has 2 minutes to get on the plane once he starts the engine. Louis tells Torrance he can't get back on the plane, and Torrance wishes him good luck. While Louis gets ammo to reload, he finds an emergency fund that John brought with him and plans to steal it. But he decides to help the others first. Torrance then contacts Trailblazer to ask for directional assistance and find a place to land. John and his men hurry to get on the plane just as it's about to take off, and Louis escapes with the cash. Dadu pulls over in front of the plane and orders his man to explode it with an RPG. But that man is suddenly killed by Louis. As he attempts to do it by himself, Torrance manages to crush him with the brake in time before he can pull the trigger. However, the plane's right engine is destroyed, and Torrance asks Delay to shut it down. The plane can't go any higher than 400 feet, so Torrance asks the air traffic controller to find him a place to land. The best option is Siasi Island, which is 50 miles due south, and Torrance barely makes it since the plane has only one engine left. Everyone cheers for him for saving their lives, and the injured passengers are immediately sent to the hospital. In the end, he contacts his daughter to tell her that he is coming home.